So now that we've looked at the variances, let's take a look at two population parameters. Specifically, we're going to look at the means, comparing two different independent means. So again, the data types applicable are interval and ratio. If you have nominal or ordinal data, this does not make any sense whatsoever. Now, there are two main scenarios concerning the differences between independent means. The first is when sigma is known for both groups. In that case, you'd use what's known as a two-sample z-test. The second is when sigma is unknown for both, or one or both, and then we'd use a two-sample t-test. Now, your book talks about how to do two-sample z-test. I'm not going to even do it here, because in reality, when do you know sigma? So we're going to concentrate on the two-sample t-test. Now, we have this exact same scenario. This is the same data, everything that we just looked at. And now we're going to concentrate on the means. Now, the assumption is that the data was obtained from two independent populations and the distributions of both populations are normal. This is the exact same thing that we did for the F-test. This is the same. Now, are they independent of each other? Yes. I mean, you have to justify. You can't just say they're independent. And we said before, they're two different machines. Now, the parameter here, I kind of skipped that. The parameter that we're interested in is mu1 versus mu2, or mu current versus mu, let me fix that real quick, nu. This is the parameter that we're interested in. Now, what we're going to see, just like when we did it with one sample t-test, we typically, unless asked for the median, we start out thinking mean. And then if we're forced to switch to it because of violation of assumptions, then we go to the medians, which is the exact same thing we're going to do here. So we need to address the normality assumption. Does the CLT apply? No, it doesn't. We already did the normal plots, and we're saying both are normal. We looked at these in a prior video, so I'm not going to repeat them here. Now, here's where things get a little bit tricky. The two-sample t-test actually has two different forms. In order to determine which form we need to use, we must first determine if the variances from each group are similar. If they are similar, then we will do what they call pool the variances. If they're not similar, then we're not going to pool. Now, think of the term pool for a second. If you're going to pool your effort with somebody, that means you're just going to combine them. You're going to work together. And that's what's going on here. If the variances are similar to each other, then we're going to numerically combine those variances. It's actually a weighted average is what it amounts to. And use the pooled variance for the test. If they are not similar, then we need to keep them separate and use the separate variances for the test. Now, to determine if they're similar, we're going to use an F-test. Now, your textbook makes reference to a rule of thumb and looking at box plots. I prefer to use an F-test and stay with the p-values rather than using the rule of thumb. It's really kind of a personal choice. However, for my students, you don't have that personal choice. We're going to be using an F-test. However, other professors teaching this course and using these videos may prefer the rule of thumb or the box plot, which is fine. So again, check with your professor to see what he or she wants you to do. Now, we've already done this F-test. We already did it. And we already looked at the assumptions, but if this was the initial problem that we're doing, if we didn't do the early one, then of course you need both normal plots, both of them. And remember, they both have to be normal. If one is not normal, then we have a violation of assumptions. And obviously, if both are not normal, we have a violation of the assumptions. So the null hypothesis, this is a quick review, would be sigma squared of the, I'm going to use current. No, actually, you know what? I'm going to switch this up this time just to make a point to you. I'm going to do sigma squared of the nu divided by sigma squared of the current equals 1. This means they're the same. And sigma squared of the nu divided by sigma squared of the current. Now here, it doesn't really matter which order because this is always going to be not equal to 1 because we want to know if they are similar. Whoops. We don't really care if one is necessarily bigger than the other, or as in which one. Now, the original problem said to make the comparison, but that's what the F-test, as we did initially for. When we're doing an F-test as part of a two-sample T-test, then we don't care which one's bigger, it's just not equal. And we put alpha at 0.05. And remember before, our p-value is 0.07 something or other. So what do you think is going to happen when we change this to not equal and then update? The p-value is basically going to double. And also, if you didn't notice the first time, as soon as you hit update, when you're using the data, these are filled in so you can see your sample standard deviation and sample size. Now, in this case, the sample sizes are the same, but there's no requirement, there's no expectation for these to be the same. These could be different sample sizes. So the p-value was 0.1592. The decision was fail to reject. Okay, now this says they are similar. This says they are not similar. So if we fail to reject, they were saying it looks like they are similar. So the conclusion is that the variances are similar. And if they're similar, we want to pool. So therefore, pool. I'm going to say pool equals yes. We will pool. And if you're not familiar, I think I've used this symbol before. Those three dots, that means therefore. So what's extremely important is that you understand this p-value is attached to this f-test. And the only reason we did it is decide whether we're going to pool or not. We have not compared the means yet. This is just one step along the way. That's why I did the f-test originally, just to compare the variances, so that we'd understand this process here. So now that I know that I will pool, I'm going to come down, and I'm going to set up my hypothesis statement. Now, the null hypothesis, there's two different ways you can write this. One way you can say that the mean of the current is equal to the mean of the nu, but this is exactly the same as saying the mean of the current minus the mean of the nu equals zero. Algebraically, those are equivalent. I don't really care, honestly, which one you use. Just pick one that makes sense to you, really. I tend to work with this, and actually TC Stats is set up in this format, but they're equivalent. So the null hypothesis with the mean of the current, now remember we wanted to check to see if the process reduced the variability and the means. So the mean of the current would be greater than the mean of the nu, which is equivalent to saying the mean of the current minus the mean of the nu is greater than zero. Now, I could have easily switched the order. If I did, if I put the nu first, then this would be less than zero because a small number minus a bigger one would be less than zero. That's all. So just make sure you know what order you have it and then set it up properly. And I'm going to stay with 0.05 because nor in the problem did it say a specific significance level to look at. So now I'm set up to do my two-sample t-test. So back in TC Stats, I'll select two samples, and then you'll see two sample T right on top, right here. And my data is still selected from last time. And the default here is actually correct, but it doesn't really matter if you change that. But again, I always tell my students to do that. Now, if you wanted to do a confidence interval for the difference of the two means, simply put in the confidence level there. Because we have data, I'm going to select use selected data. If I had sample statistics, I could put them in here, but I have the data, so I'm not going to bother with this. And the order here, the first sample is current, the second is new. That's important because this is current minus new, which matches exactly what I wrote on the paper. If I had them backwards, all I'd have to do is tap switch order and it changes the order for me. I need to hit it again to get back. Now, remember the question about the pool variances? The pool variance says yes. That means I need to turn this on. So I'm telling TC Stats to go ahead and pool the variances for me. If I would have rejected and said the variances are not similar, then I would have left that off. Now I'll simply tap update. And there's everything I know. There's the p value, there's the value of t, here's a pooled standard deviation, and the degrees of freedom. So the p value, I'm going to write down here 0.0697. And off the side, I'm going to put, where should I put it? Right here is good. The value of t was 1.5216. Decision is going to be fail to reject because this is greater than alpha. And the conclusion is there is not enough evidence. That actually says evidence. I kind of scribbled that, sorry. To suggest the new process has a, say, smaller mean. Now, just quickly here, I want to go back to TC Stats and I want to turn the pooled variances off and update. See the difference in p value? It was 0.06 something or other, 9, and now it's 0.07 something or other. Now, because our alpha is 0.05, it would not have made a difference in this case. But suppose this p value turned out to be like 0.049, something very, very close to 0.05, we would have rejected. And then here, when I turned it off, it would have brought me over 0.05, so I would have failed to reject. So it is very important that you determine whether you should pool or not, because it can actually have a tremendous impact on your result or your final conclusion. Now you may notice here the degrees of freedom are not N1 minus 1 and N2 minus 2 combined some way on this t-test. When you look in your book, you will see that there's two different ways to calculate the degrees of freedom. When we pool, the degrees of freedom equals N1 plus N2 minus 2, which is same as simply N1 minus 1 plus N2 minus 1. When we do not pool, the degrees of freedom are a little bit more interesting. Degrees of freedom would be S1 squared over N1 plus S2 squared over N2. Now this whole thing will be squared. Then, hope I left myself enough room. We're going to divide this by S1 squared over N1 squared plus S2 squared over N2 squared. And I did kind of run out of room because I need to divide this by N1 minus 1 and this by N2 minus 1. You probably can't even read that. That's N2 minus 1 divided right there. And this is N1 minus 1 divided right there. So this is a little bit more interesting algebraically. Fortunately, TC Stats handles all that for you, so you don't have to mess around with a calculator trying to figure that out. But the point is, or the reason I want to point that out, is you can see the degrees of freedom here has a decimal component to it. And that's the reason the formula is different. So that's the process that we follow to determine or to compare two independent means when the assumptions are satisfied, so we can use a two-sample t. Now, just to recap very briefly all of what happened here, because a bunch just happened. So for a two-sample t, again, we're taking a look at two different means. That's what we're comparing, two different means. The assumptions are both groups distributed normal, or CLT applies for both, which is incidentally the exact same assumptions for an F test. And then we're going to break off and do an F test to see if the variances are similar. Now, if you fail to reject on the F test, then pool equals yes, you will pool. If you reject on the F test, then pool equals no. And these yes and no makes reference to what you're going to do when you go back and do the two sample T. And then you would complete the two sample T test based on the results here. Now, you're going to have, as a reminder, you're going to have a p-value here. And this p-value is to make a decision on the pooling. You're going to get another p-value here. And this p-value would make a decision regarding the means. So you're going to actually have two different p-values that tell you two different things. I apologize if it sounds like I'm beating this into the ground, but this students get confused on this so horribly that I really feel like I want to emphasize it. The first p-value for the F-test is about pooling, yes or no. The second p-value is for the T-test, and that tells you whether the means, one means bigger than the other or not equal, or however you set up your hypothesis statement.